is the Lexikon der Indogermanischen Verben. It is a dictionary of all the verbs in Proto-Indo-European, a language that was the ancestor of a wide swath of languages across Asia, as well as most of the languages in Europe, including English. It's also a language so dead that it left no written records and has had no living speakers in over 5,000 years. How can linguists reconstruct so much detail about a language when we seemingly have no evidence of its existence? Well, linguists use an approach called the comparative method, and it stems from one very simple rule. Sound change is overwhelmingly regular. What is sound change, you might ask? You know how people who live in different parts of, like, the US or Great Britain have different accents? Like, one of the things about those accents is they pronounce words differently? Basically, it's like that. It's language change that affects the sound system of a language. So, for instance, I'm from Austin, Texas, and my dialect of English has undergone something called the pin-pen merger. Or, as I am wont to call it, the pin-pin merger. Yeehaw! What does this mean? Well, originally English had a distinction between the sounds N and in, but not anymore in my dialect. They have just merged into one single sound, in. And not just in pin, either. It happened pretty much everywhere that sound shows up. So we got kin and kin, gym and gym, windy and windy, sinned and sinned. Yeah, it goes on. Anyway, the key point here is that this sound change applied pretty much everywhere that that sound shows up. It's not like every word in my lexicon got rewritten. It's like a switch flipped in the way I pronounce that particular sound. This is what we mean when we say sound change is overwhelmingly regular. So, how do we move from individual sound changes to reconstructing whole languages? Well, you could imagine how if you ran the clock long enough, you would go from dialects that sound sort of weird but are still understandable to different languages where the speakers cannot understand each other at all. But if you work backwards, you could figure out what sound changes had happened, and by undoing those sound changes, you could find out what the word sounded like in the original language. That's how the comparative method works, and that's what the LIV is on a grand scale. You find words in the daughter languages that you hypothesize originally came from the same word in the parent language. That set of words is called a correspondence set, and the individual words are called cognates. And then you work out the sound correspondences and what sound changes must have happened and what the original sounds must have been in the parent language. So, let's do it! Let's reconstruct us some Proto-Indo-European! First correspondence set, 2. Latin, duo. Greek, duo. Sanskrit, dwa. So something looks a little weird with the vowels. Sanskrit has well, Latin and Greek both have o, and there seems to be an alternation between glide and the full vowel with u and wa. But we can say for certain that Indo-European had the sound duh. Of course, if you were doing this for reals, you would want to have a ton of examples that illustrated your point, but this is a video, so we're just gonna use one and move on. Next correspondence set, 3. Latin, tres. Greek, tres. Sanskrit, trias. Ta, ra, and sa are the same across all three languages, and from that we can infer that they correspond to Proto-Indo-European, ta, ra, and sa. But let's take a closer look at the vowel situation, shall we? Where Latin and Greek have e, Sanskrit has a. And where Latin and Greek have o, Sanskrit also has a. We have two possibilities here. Possibility 1. Proto-Indo-European had both e and o, which merged into a in Sanskrit. Possibility 2. Proto-Indo-European just had a, which then split into e and o in Latin and Greek based on some sort of conditioning we don't know yet. We don't have the information at this point to know which possibility happened, but hold that thought. Anyway, next correspondence set. Bet you can guess. 4. Latin, quatuor. Greek, tesseres. Sanskrit, catúr. What? It actually gets worse if you start poking around in Greek, because Greek has different dialects, and it turns out that different dialects have different words for 4. For example, the Attic form is tetares and the Lesbian form is pesures. But we also luck out because there's one dialect of Greek called Mycenaean, which dates from hundreds of years earlier than those other dialects, and it gives us the form quetropopi, or quadrupeds. So we can say Greek votes for qua. Now, what is going on with Sanskrit? Yeah, actually, what is the problem with Sanskrit? Because I was just reading through my friendly Sanskrit grammar here, and there is one way of forming the past tense that is really weird. I mean, one that we're going to talk about now, not like one total. So it's called the perfect, and the way you form the perfect is that you take, usually, the first consonant off of the root, you add a, you slap it on the front of the word, and then the rest of the word undergoes some changes, which is great. But then we get to the root cur, make or do, whose third singular is chakara, and whose third plural is chakre. Why did that cha happen there? So we go poking around in related languages, and we come to Greek, which has the same way of forming the past tense, also called the perfect, actually. And we come across a form like leloipa, from the root lip, meaning leave. And, remember earlier when I was talking about the vowels and I said we couldn't tell which of the two possibilities had happened, whether e and o had merged as a in Sanskrit or whether a in Proto-Indo-European had split into e and o in Greek or Latin? Well, now we have enough information to figure it out. Notice how in the Sanskrit forms we only ever see cha in front of what is e in Greek. And notice how we see k, just a plain k, in front of a consonant or what is an o in Greek. How could Sanskrit know to make those changes if it did not itself have a distinction between e and o in the past? It couldn't! Problem solved! So we can reconstruct Proto-Indo-European e and o, where we see e and o in Greek, along with a rule that merges e and o into a in Sanskrit. And we can reconstruct a rule in Sanskrit that converts qua to ka and then ka to cha in front of e, but before the rule that converted e to a. Glorious victory! All right, that is the show. Thanks for watching. Please be sure to like and subscribe and support me on Patreon like these fine people. And yeah, have a great day!